The journey to legalized marijuana has found its way back to California voters.
Prop 64 would make it legal for anyone over 21 years old to consume marijuana. But there's more to it.
Who will enforce this law?
So what about people driving high?
What if I want to grow it?
Is it safe?
What is the economic impact for California?
Will crime decrease?
Where does the money go?
Tonight, we answer your questions and ask,
are we ready for California high? Well, ready or not, that question goes before California voters in less than 2 weeks now. And it's a big one with complex and sometimes contradictory answers that a lot of people are struggling to sort out.
And Edie, to understand where all this may take us, it's important to look at just how far we've already come.
That funny, funny, funny reefer man. He smokes a reef, he gets high, then he flies to the sky.
There's been a colorful past for the green plant with the spiky leaves. Whatever you choose to call it, marijuana, cannabis, pot, or as the 1930s film referred to it,
the burning weed with its roots in hell.
Declared a Schedule I narcotic by the federal government, public service campaigns abounded.
It's what slowly happens to you when you keep smoking pot.
Die with the ticket to Mexico.
But with the 1960s came a whole new mindset and a whole new attitude about weed.
Is it heavy stuff, man? Will it blow me away?
Movies and TV shows began to show more people using marijuana.
Let's roll another joint.
Then in 1996, California legalized medical marijuana, creating a whole industry and a gap in regulations the legislature is still trying to fix today.
The law just covers, you know, cultivation and possession.
Leading us to Proposition 64. If approved by voters, Prop 64 would make it legal for anyone over 21 to use marijuana.
But Prop 64 is about more than just making it legal to smoke pot. It's a lot more complicated than that. Let's take a look at what you will and will not see.
First off, you will not see pot in stores like Raley's or Target.
What you will see are stores that have to get state licenses to sell pot, kind of like the medical dispensaries, only bigger.
And some cities could ban it from being sold at all.
You will be able to smoke it at home.
You will not be able to smoke it in public places like a park. In fact, the fine if you're caught the first time would be $100.
And you cannot drive and smoke pot either.
You will see the number of pot-related arrests go down.
But states that already legalized pot saw their crime rates and the amount of black market pot go up.
You will see a sort of nutrition label telling you how strong the pot is.
You will see where it was made and whether chemicals were used on the marijuana. So those are the Prop 64 basics, but there is a lot more going on here than just that, and some strong opinions on both sides.
So let's start with the supporters. They see a wide range of benefits, but as we found out, they don't all see eye to eye. We caught up with 22-year-old Shanisha Candies on her way to work. She's voting in favor of Prop 64. Candy says she doesn't use, but her fiance does. He has a medical marijuana card for back pain.
And when you have a card, you have to renew it every year. So he'll actually be saving money. So I'm pretty sure he'll just go inside the store.
Candies also believes that pot is safer than other legal substances.
I'm still with it because alcohol is worse than marijuana, in my words. So.
Lieutenant Governor Gavin Newsom has been a leading proponent since the measure's inception 3 years ago. That's when he put together a panel to study the issue.
We're going to learn a lot about the issues of credit card use and banking and all the federal related issues.
He says he led the legalization drive because prohibition has disproportionately affected the poor and people of color. This proposition could clear the records and open doors for thousands of people with marijuana convictions like Brian Rosenthal.
It was cultivation of over a pound, which in California is a felony. So it has followed me and is still following me to this day.
Here we have a cannabis.
Kimberly Cargyle also wants recreational use legalized. She runs a medical marijuana dispensary in East Sacramento, and she'd like to see more adults have access to her goods.
I believe that with the passage of Proposition 64, we will have a number of marketplaces open up for those people, those adults who are interested in a non-toxic alternative to alcohol.
She says a therapeutic alternative will stay as is, a medical dispensary, but she'd also like to get in on the recreational use business.
I do have many dreams of different businesses that would support adults using cannabis in a responsible manner.
Cargill says she's not alone, and she anticipates others are making similar plans. But there's a divide in the cannabis industry. Tawny Logan is the director of the Sonoma Growers Association. She'd like to see California legalize recreational use, but she's against Prop 64, fearful it would allow mass producers to push the small cultivators out of business.
What do I really want to have on the shelf? Do I want to have three options on the shelf by three corporations, or do I want to have 50 options on the shelf? And 40 of those being from my local producers.
Now, even if Prop 64 passes in November, the earliest you might see recreational pot shops open is 2018. It'll take at least a year to get the regulatory system, which tracks the industry from seeds to sales, up and running.
Supporters of Prop 64 see promise and potential, but others see nothing but problems. And opponents say none is bigger than the physical and psychological toll marijuana can have on users, especially those who get hooked. And as KCRA3's Kevin Oliver tells us, it's not just users who can feel the effects.
He thought he could have as much as possible, any amount that he wanted, and it wouldn't do anything to him.
Christy, who didn't want us to use her last name, has a son who she says is addicted to marijuana. The English professor voted for medical marijuana 20 years ago and now fears her son has paid the price.
I didn't realize that it was going to be, you know, so become so widespread that my own child was going to be using it for no reason other than because he was addicted to it.
She says her son took his first puff at age 11. And older friends with medical marijuana cards supplied the pot.
Now I realize that he was addicted and he could not stop. He could not control his use.
By the time her son was in college, Christy said he had totaled the family car, was arrested several times, and ultimately had a psychotic break.
The kids routinely pursue cigarettes. Tobacco cigarettes is very dangerous, and marijuana is like there's nothing wrong with it. And that's just not true.
But some drug policy experts and supporters of Prop 64 question links between cannabis and health and substance abuse issues, saying the tight controls by the federal government have hindered research.
Unfortunately, our model of studying drug use among the general population in this country is pretty horrific. I feel one of the reasons is that we don't want people to understand that there is quite a bit of drug use that happens in the general public and that most of it is non-problematic.
Law enforcement agencies have other concerns. Officers anticipate a dramatic rise in drug driving.
We are just asking for disaster. That traffic fatality number in California, in my opinion, is going to double or even exceed that.
Keep going.
While the public has recognized 0.08 as the legal limit for blood alcohol, a similar measurement has yet to be established for marijuana, in part because what makes a driver high can't be measured the same way. A handful of other states have established THC limits within the blood for what those states consider under the influence. But California has no THC limit, and Prop 64 doesn't address the issue. In Sacramento, Kevin Oliver, KCRA 3 News.
So those are some of the drawbacks and the benefits as seen by supporters and opponents of Proposition 64. But who's right? And how would this law really work?
To find out, we headed to a state where recreational marijuana is already allowed and visited two cities that take very different approaches to legalized pot. As Californians consider adult use marijuana, we came to a place that's already been doing it for a couple of years. We're in Denver, Colorado, to find out what's working and what's not working. Colorado's fresh mountain air and bright blue skies are still its biggest draw. But legal marijuana is quickly providing the state a new identity. Last year, sales were nearly $1 billion, and the state collected $135 million in taxes and fees. And to put that in perspective, it's enough money to cover the full construction cost for Sacramento's Golden One Center in 4 years. Recreational use has been legal since 2014, but that doesn't mean it's legal to buy everywhere. Local governments can choose how they regulate marijuana sales or whether to sell it at all.
Anything else for you today?
Which brings us to the city of Greeley.
We're a normal community where you have what every community has. We have car break-ins, we have burglaries, we have an occasional armed robbery.
Jerry Garner has been Greeley's police chief for 10 years. As a career law enforcement officer, he was against the idea of legalizing pot and selling it in his city.
We talk about drug use to our kids, that it's not a good idea. If you allow it in your jurisdiction, are you giving them kind of a mixed message? The next thing you have to worry about is, well, if a youngster thinks, well, marijuana's okay, well, maybe cocaine or maybe meth, maybe that's okay too.
More drivers under the influence of drugs, more burglaries or robberies, more children going to the ER after ingesting marijuana. Garner says these are added challenges the police department doesn't need, and Greeley made the political decision that the extra revenue just wasn't worth it.
It hasn't been a disaster, but we do see some impacts on public safety that are not good.
I mean, people are going to get pot either way. It doesn't matter. I mean, Fort Collins is only 20 minutes away. Denver's 45 minutes away. So I don't think it really affects the people here.
Jessica Zimmerman and her friend Lindsay Steinmetz know Greeley well. It was home for more than 20 years. And both still live nearby. They say marijuana has definitely brought an influx of people to Colorado.
And I've seen a lot of people even not just moving here, but, you know, vacationing here, visiting friends here that they never would have visited before, because who wants to be in Greeley? But hey, we can smoke weed.
Folks in Greeley don't have to travel far to get their marijuana. Just across the city line is a town 1 square mile in size with fewer than 300 people and 4 businesses growing and selling pot. Here in Garden City, they made $1 million off of marijuana sales just last year. That's a lot of money for a community of this size, and you don't have to look far to see that money being put to good use.
This fence was actually out there on the other side of the truck. I moved it all back here, put up the pickets, and as you can see, I've got my grass coming up.
Alex Lopez is taking advantage of the town's revitalization grant program. It's paid for with marijuana money and offers up to $3,000 in matching funds to help people cut down trees, paint their homes, or in Alex's case, build a fence and pour some concrete.
You want to live in a community where people take pride in their homes, you know, their city. And all this money, you know, they're putting it to work. That's what's important.
Has there been anything negative that you've seen, though, Alex?
You know what? I haven't. I honestly haven't.
Mayor Lonel Archuleta says Garden City was founded during Prohibition.
Garden City's always been a little unique, and I know that the surrounding towns have different views than we do.
It's now seeing a rebirth thanks to marijuana.
And I know that some of our neighbors, they don't approve of us having the stores, but I know a lot of their residents come and shop at the stores.
Folks in Garden City and Greeley may not agree on the value of having adult-use marijuana, but both sides can agree Californians should not take this decision lightly.
I just think that if it passes in California, one thing that we did so we don't have stores on every corner, we put a rule where they have to be 1,000 feet apart. Can't be by any schools, any churches, anywhere there's children. We also put a cap on the licenses for the centers, so not everybody could just start growing marijuana.
Be sure you've got your information straight. I think Colorado was kind of stampeded by the pro-marijuana folks and jumped into it before we really looked at it carefully. And I think even some of the legislators that were pro-marijuana, if they would honestly tell you now, would tell you, we didn't look at this close enough. There's some things that have developed that we didn't expect.
Interesting way to end that piece. So what were some of the impacts people in Colorado did not see coming?
Edie, that's where it gets interesting. And when we come back, we're going to talk about crime in Colorado. Also, Denver's new homeless problem. And we will meet some people who are making a lot of money off marijuana, but it's not necessarily what you might expect when our Commitment 2016 special, California High, continues.
Welcome back to California High, our Commitment 2016 special on Proposition 64. We're talking about Colorado's experience with legalized marijuana and some of the unexpected consequence. Brian was there for several days doing this reporting, and you saw one of those involves homelessness.
It does, Edie, absolutely. The high life does have a downside, and in Denver, Colorado, you don't have to look hard to see it. The city is dealing with a growing homeless problem. Civic Center Park, which is right across from the street from the state
state capitol filled with homeless of all ages. Experts we talked to say the problem is being fueled by recreational marijuana use. In the neighboring city of Aurora, Colorado, there are about a dozen pot shops with homeless nearby. City leaders say some came for legalized marijuana. Others expected they'd find jobs in the pot industry, but there's a lot of competition for those jobs. Applicants need to pass background checks, so they never got the jobs, and some ended up on the street.
Backers of Prop 64 here in California have said that legalizing recreational marijuana will free up law enforcement to deal with other more serious crimes. You took a look at that in Colorado. How did that work out?
Yeah, we talked with Colorado's Attorney General and the state marijuana czar, and both of them said that it will reduce some crimes, but they say it also brought them a whole new set of problems. Colorado Attorney General Cynthia Kaufman says legal pot has done little to end the black market. She says it's only shifted the problem. And while Andrew Friedman, Colorado's marijuana czar, says home grows have created what's called a gray market, where pot is grown legally but sold illegally.
What we are seeing is that the routes that were traditionally used to bring in marijuana from the South are now being used to bring in heroin, and particularly brown powder heroin. From Mexico, which is exceptionally strong.
There's been criminals who have seen our loose home grow laws and said, I'll just grow 99 plants in my basement and ship it to a different state, and I will make a lot of money doing that. And so it's something we really have to figure out how to shut down.
Prop 64 allows people to grow 6 plants per household, but the plants can't be visible to the public. Medical users could decide to form a collective with up to 5 people and grow pot on more than one lot, on just one lot.
So if California voters do approve Prop 64, one thing that we know for sure is that it's going to involve a lot of money. So what did you find about the business side of all this?
Yeah, so Edie, Colorado's first recreational pot shops opened in January of 2014. I visited 2 of them, and I found them to be well-oiled machines with the state monitoring everything from seed to sale. A drive through Garden City, Colorado won't take but a minute. Unless you want to shop for marijuana. This little town of fewer than 300 people is home to Nature's Herbs and Wellness, an oasis of green.
And we do have some loyalty points. Are we using it or letting them keep going?
With glass cabinets full of golden pineapple, ice, and grapefruit, people are spending big bucks on pot.
It was amazing how many people had never even tried it or thought about it until it was legal.
Owner John Rotherham runs 3 retail marijuana shops in Colorado with plans to expand to California. His nose for the business has earned him the reputation of a marijuana mogul.
It's a big challenge because they're changing rules and regulations constantly. I'm pretty much, I feel like an attorney anymore in this field.
If Rotherham is the brains behind the business.
I grew my first pot plant on my own when I was 14 years old.
Head grower Tucker Eldridge is the brains behind the bud. Few can talk THC better than him. Eldridge says because of strict regulation and tracking tags, his product is better and safer than the marijuana sold on the street.
We're almost required by law to provide a cleaner, more high quality product because of the testing regulations that are in place. I know there's no salmonella. I know I have no E. coli.
Eldridge cares for the plants like family. And speaking of family, you'll find Rotherham's own parents hard at work in the trim room.
When he told us what he was going to do, I asked him, like, what do you know about marijuana? And he says, well, Mom, you'd be surprised.
10 or 15 years ago, if I told you you'd be sitting here doing this right now, what would you say?
I just said, you're probably crazy. for one thing, I never thought they'd make it legal. Because when I grew up, it was like, well, I was told when I was little, you know, if you took one puff of this stuff, you're hooked for life. So we never touched it.
And many pot users don't smoke. They choose to eat. Bob Esquino is a co-founder of Incredibles, a Denver-based company that specializes in edible marijuana products.
We've tried different things, but people like to have it mixed in with chocolate. People like to have it mixed in with a cookie or a brownie. People like to have it mixed in with a gummy.
In the Incredibles kitchen, employees crank out thousands of treats a day. The items might look like candy, but Esquino is quick to point out they shouldn't be taken lightly.
So we make sure that it's kept in child-resistant packaging. We make sure that everything is labeled properly. We make sure that everything is tested so you know exactly what you're getting.
One of the challenges with edibles is portion control, making sure you don't get too much. Every bar made at Incredibles has this label telling you exactly how much THC is in each square. Think of THC as liquid gold in the marijuana world. And Derek Cummings has the job of turning it all into cold hard cash. He says edibles have come a long way from when he first started using pot.
And I was like, wait a minute, this is like what I made in middle school. Eighth grade, we tried this out. Like, this is crazy. And that was the extent of edibles. And that day I went home and my buddy's like, man, you should just make your own.
With legal pot becoming a billion-dollar industry for Colorado, it's easy to understand why California may want a piece of the action. A recent study by the University of the Pacific Center for Business and Policy Research found the greater Sacramento area could turn into a cannabis hub, reaping 20,000 jobs and generating more than $4 billion in business. But before that happens, voters need to approve recreational marijuana, and local leaders will have to choose to allow new marijuana businesses to flower in their neighborhoods. And John Rotherham says he's already planning to expand to California if Prop 64 passes. He tells me he's already been looking at sites, Edie, in Southern California.
Looking at the real estate. You know, there are a lot of people lining up if this passes. What are the odds that it will this time?
There's been a lot of polling done, and it is polling as high as 60%, but some polls show it just barely ahead. So it's going to be very interesting to see what happens. But most polls do show that it is leaning toward passage.
So a majority or all the way up to 60%, yeah, which would be pretty strong. All right. Well, stay with us. We'll be right back.
When it comes to legalizing recreational marijuana use in California, there are a lot of unknowns, and the experiences of one state may not necessarily be those of another.
But we do know if Prop 64 is approved, it's likely to have far-reaching impacts on a lot of Californians for many years to come. So we urge you to study all of the issues and races and, of course, cast your vote on November 8th. Thanks for watching.